Good. Yesterday, we learned about the redemption, Geula. The whole reason the Jewish people are here, the whole reason God created the world, was an order that should be Geula. And what does Geula mean? What does Geula mean? That the world should be healthy. That's all. What's the difference between a sick person and a healthy person? A lot of times, just is missing vitamins. The world is missing vitamins, right? As soon as the world gets vitamins, then the world becomes alive. So the world, the way it is terrible. The world is awful, right? The world it is. But in essence, the world is very good. It says in the sixth day of creation that God saw everything he made and everything was very good. And the Rebbe said once in a speech that this seems to be even after Adam sinned with the eating the tree. Nevertheless, everything is good, but it's good and it's sick. The world is good, but it's sick. So the world has to be made healthy, fed, given some vitamins. So, and there's when that happens, all of a sudden everything just becomes transformed. Everything becomes transformed. There's a thing. There's a lot of times people that are bedridden, so they develop boils, and so they have to have special mattresses. In other words, when a person is sick, especially if he's bedridden, especially if he's unconscious, so all sorts of bad results come from this, right? The person all of a sudden is he gets thin, his limbs start to atrophy, and he gets boils on his back, and all these terrible things happen, right? That's the same thing with the world. The world, if it's not healthy. So all of a sudden, there's all this crime and there's all these weird, movements popping up and wars and hatred and famine and disease and death and things like that. All these things pop up in the world only because the world is sick. As soon as you make the world healthy, then all these how do you say the negative, I try to think of the word. There's a word that goes the things that accompany. Anyway, these accompanying the diseases and conditions, they disappear. They simply disappear. Right? A person becomes healthy, wants to move his arms, and suddenly they start moving, and they become not atrophied and bent and crooked and things like that, and he becomes. A person he starts to think logically. So that's the point of the whole world. We're talking about the whole world. The world as it is sick, or it's dying of hunger, dying of thirst. So we Jews have to provide the water and the air and the vitamins to the world. That's our job. So the Rebbe likens it to the word geula. The word geula is composed of really two aspects. There's gola, which means exile, and that's four letters of the word geula. Geula is a five-letter word, and gola, exile, is four of them. So here's the word gola. Is four of them. All we have to do is put the aleph in. All we have to do is, like we say, you get a sick person, you feed them something. Give him a little bit of food, all of a sudden he becomes a different person, right? All of these other symptoms and conditions that accompany his sickness and things like that, and the boils and the bed boils, whatever they're called, and they all go away. And that's the same thing in the world. As soon as a little bit of godliness is revealed in the world, then all these bad things go away. Okay. So let's see, here we go. 1 minute. Okay, right. So the Rambam explains that really, oh, here, this is where we got up to. So the Rambam explains that Maimonides, and he's the only one that really has laws about Mashiach, what Mashiach is supposed to be, and how what he's going to do. So he explains that really what he's explained basically is the first period of the coming of the Mashiach, where there won't be any major miracles like raising of the dead. The culmination will be raising of the dead. The Maimonides says that's one of the 13 principles of faith, that the dead are going to raise. I mean, that you don't see every day. True, once in a while, there was the raising of the dead. That Ezekiel, it says he brought like 20,000 people back from the dead, just bones that had been dead for, what, 500 years? How long? He brought it back. And we see that Elijah the prophet brought somebody back from the dead. And there's other stories of people, but there's Tanayim, Moroyim that brought people back from the dead. Okay. So we say, but that everybody comes back from the dead, that you don't see, right? And that's going to be, so that's pretty major miracles that's going to be. But nevertheless, the Mashiach is going to come in the beginning. There's not going to be miracles. Things are just going to start to be healthy. Things are going to be healthy. There's not going to be any more, how do you say, war in the world. And so we can see this one thing from a Mishnah in Pirkei Avot. The Mishnah says like this: Histakel b'shlosha devarim, look at three things, and you won't come to do any sins. Oh, here it goes over here. Okay. Explanation is like this. There's a Mishnah that says like this. Mishnah in Pirkei Avot. Then we learn now in the days between Passover and Shavuot, and some people extend it. In Chabad, we also extend it to Rosh Hashanah. We learn Pirkei Avot. Six chapters of Pirkei Avot. And one of them says like this. The first chapter in Pirkei Avot, in the first Mishnah in the third chapter of Pirkei Avot, it says, look at three things and you will not come to do a sin. That's what it says. Look at three things and you won't come to do a sin. What are the three things? It seems that the Mishnah tells you what they are. And it continues and it says, what are these three things? You should know where you came from, where you're going, and before whom are you going to have to give an accounting, right? Well, and it explains, where'd you come from? You came from a little seed. Where are you going? You're going to a place that's worms going to eat you up. Who's going to judge your soul? God. Okay, that's what it says. So the question is asked, why does the Mishnah have to say, look at three things and you won't come to do a sin? You can see that there's three things. Why do you have to say that there's three things? Even if we want to say that this number is an important number, why does the Mishnah have to waste time telling us the number? Anyone can see that there's three things. It should have just said, should know that you came from a little seed and that you're going to a place of worms, and that you'll be judged by God. That's all. Right. What does it have to say? No three things. Why do you have to say no three things? Hari kol echad v'echad, anyone can count himself and see that there are three things. Says the Rebbe, okay, maybe we can say that the Mishnah is just trying to, you know, assert itself, that we should remember. Sometimes it does that. But the Rebbe is going to give a little different answer. Based on what we could say, one of the explanations in this is that the words of the Mishnah look at three things, that the language of the Mishnah is usually very, very economical. The Mishnah is usually very terse. It doesn't use extra words. When the Mishnah says, look at three things, it's not coming, this is not like a forward, an announcement to tell you what these things are going to be. In Kavanah Sorak, it's not only talking about the three things that are going to come afterwards. Of course, simply speaking, that is what it's talking about, and there's not no big problem. But still, there's a little bit of a problem. It didn't really have to say those three things. Says the Rebbe, I want to tell you what I think. I think that why does it say three things? That's three other things. Elagam inyan shlosh devorim b'chalal, in general, the Mishnah is giving us two teachings over here. What three things you have to look at. Where you come from, where you're going, who's going to judge you. That's number one. But number two is you always have to look at three things, not these three things. What are they? A person, every person, constantly in his life should always look at three things. In addition to the three things that come after, where you come from, where you're going, who's going to judge you? There's three other things you should always look at. And by means of this, you will not come to do any sins. A person might think that he has to only have to look at two things in life, himself and God. We're religious Jews. We should look at ourselves and our God and God. So to speak, I am serving God and I should think about God. How does it say in Shema Yisrael, the motto of Judaism? You should love God with all of your heart, all of your soul, all of your might. God, me and God. I was created only in order to serve God. No, that's so there's two things. What about the world? The world should not disturb me. That's what you might think. It says, Anomba, the Mishnah says, Istaka Bashlosh Debrahim, you should not live your life only you and God. Adam Tzorich Litbonen, a person has to contemplate, think deeply, look and see that there are really three things that you should be looking at constantly. Nosef Al HaMetziut, in addition to yourself, in addition to God, so to speak, there is also a third thing. And what is the third thing? The world. Metziut Olam Shenivra, the world that was created by means of God. Sha'al Yadoda, by means of the world, by thinking of these three things, then a Jew can serve God. Tachlit Briyat Olam, the whole world, reason God created the world and put the soul into the world, into a physical body in the world. And the world is a terrible place, a low place that there's nothing lower than it. The reason God did this terrible thing, he is lemalot, at the kavana, to fill an intention. God had a reason. What's the reason? God wanted that it should be a dwelling for him in the low place. She Yehudi, that a God, that a Jew, al yedei avodah, so by means of his serving, God, Yevorer, will refine the Yizachech and clarify his body, his natural soul, and the physical world around him. V'yasem, he calls it, and this will all become a dwelling for God. In other words, make the world healthy. Make the world a healthy place. Though the world should not obscure the life force which is in the world, the purpose of the world. And this a person does by means of avodah soul, working with his body in this physical world, in doing Torah and the commandments. Now, interestingly enough, God gave the Torah on Mount Sinai. God gave the commandments on Mount Sinai. And I can't stress this enough, that before this world was created, there was no existence. There was no existence. Existence began when this world was created. God, so to speak, does not exist in the way we understand existence. God's existence is totally unlike anything that we can define or experience. It's not spiritual. God creates the spiritual. God creates all being. So God is not dependent. That's why people say, well, who created God? God is not a being like any other being. God is not, right? God is not an existence like any other existence. God cannot be defined. But as soon as God created the world, which that began everything, so then there's a relationship between God and the world. And as soon as he gave the Torah, there's even more of a relationship. That's what we said, partnership, that we became partners with God. It makes no sense. That's why every time the Rebbe mentions God, he always says, kivyachol, so to speak, right? So to speak. We are, because we can't say that God is like a big person, a big angel, a huge angel, and a great, amazing, amazing, you know, king angel of all the other angels there are. God is the king of all the king of the, all the all the angel kings. He's the thing of the, God also is that. He also is that, right? That's also true. Of course God is. God listens to our prayers. He listens to all prayers. He listens to everybody's prayers. And so God is much closer than we think, but he's more, infinitely further than we think. But the reason that God did this whole business is an incredible mystery, but it all is rounded up into one sentence, which in a way we can say that's sort of the motto of Chabad, is Diro B'Tachtonim. God wants that he should be revealed here. Al yaday kiyum, by means of doing the commandments with physical things in the world, we refine and we clarify this physical thing that we're working with, and we make from it a vessel for godliness. Just like, for instance, the commandment of charity. The commandment of charity, the commandment of charity is equal to all the other commandments. And the main commandment, it's the main commandment, in some ways, it's greater than all the other commandments. And the Jew could take from the money that I worked for, from my physical money, that I could do things with. I could buy food, I could buy a new suit with it. But notain, and I give my money to God. How do I give money to God? To a poor person. A poor person. I'm doing what with my money what God wants. I'm making it, it's not my money anymore. All of a sudden it becomes God's money. And this poor person, it's God's poor person. So the world becomes elevated. The Inyan Ashlishi, that's the third thing. Look at three things to make a dwelling, namely to make a dwelling place for God in the world. In other words, don't just think about yourself and God, think about the world. This is in you. It's not a side thing. It's not an extra. The main thing is me and God. And also there's the world, you know. No, even more. This is the main essence of the whole business. God and man that serves are really, the whole essence of it is to fix the world. Nit'ava Kodesh Baruch Hu, God wants that there should be dwelling in the world. This is the whole essence of man and the whole reason he came into the world. So for instance, if you're in the world, the Rebbe once spoke, I remember, it was my teacher, Rabbi Moshe Naparstak, he told me, he said that once he was by a sikha, by the Rebbe, they stayed up all night, and the Rebbe made a sikha, it was like on Shavuos. He says, a person, a big Talmud Chacham, he wakes up at midnight, and he sits and he learns the Torah, and he's learning alone, and he's really understanding, and all of a sudden he hears a voice, and the voice says, there's a little Jewish child that he doesn't know anything about Judaism, and he's right in your neighborhood. And what will enable him to know Torah is a little candy. You go with a little candy, and you say, I'll give you this candy, say one sentence of the Torah. And that little child is crying out, how can you sit and learn Torah and not thinking about it? In other words, your relationship between you and God, 100%. You've gotten to the point where you've learned Torah, you know Torah, you're learning the Torah, saying the words of Torah, and wonderful. It's quiet, you're godly, you're spiritual, and everything. You're really burning. And all of a sudden, they think, but what about the world? What about the world? Me and God are okay, but what about the world? God wants that there should be a dwelling in the world to fix up the world. What about all those Jews that are drowning in the darkness of ignorance in the world? Huh? What about them? The ad kedekach, to the degree, nogea lolod, and this should be so important to you that you look at three things, should be shvil zeh, because of this, hayata, the whole reason why your soul was brought into the world, by means of God. Mibali hebet, notwithstanding the tremendous highness, how the soul was before it came into the world. Like it says in the Shama Shinatat li bitahorehi, the soul that you put into me was pure. The ain shom makom, when the soul was in upper worlds, there was no place for any sins or bad thoughts or bad desires, getting angry, having lust, getting depressed. There was no thing that the opposite of being pure and happy. And what did God do? God sent the soul down below. Ata barata, you created it, you formed it, you blew it into me. Ad la olam asiyah, until this physical world. Sham yeshno et achayim v'tatov. Here in this physical world is what's called the good, the life and good, and the opposite. It says that I put in front of you the blessing and the curse, life and the good, and the opposite of the blessing, good, death. And it says, and choose life. And the Alter Rebbe says, who wouldn't choose life? He says, no, you don't understand. A person that chooses the pleasures of this world, he's choosing death. That's choosing, he really thinks he's living it up, right? He's having a great time. The guy who's sitting learning the Torah, he's just stuck in his little, you know, black and white world. And I'm going to a big opera, to a big, you know, what is, rock and roll party or something. And I'm having a good time. But it ends up that the person who was learning the Torah, he was really attaching himself to something eternal. And the person who went to the big, whatever it is, rave party or something like that, it's just gone. There's just nothing left from it. Maybe somebody took a picture or something, which could be that he's even ashamed of the picture. But also the derech hasheni, the other, which is the opposite. God, so why did God put us into this terrible, terrible world? The world is just a big trap. Why? Achin neshama, that the soul has to have shmir. It says atam neshama bekirbi. You have to pray to God for help in this world. Leave the soul in the upper worlds, and then it's okay. The soul is good. He says no, but if you're in the upper worlds, you're only looking at two things: yourself and God. In fact, when you're in the upper worlds, you're only looking at one thing. You're looking at God. You don't have to fix yourself up at all. God put the world, the soul into the world where there's all sorts of pitfalls and all sorts of terrible things in order to fulfill the intention of making a dwelling for God in the lower world. Lechior, at first glance, the descent of the soul into the body, this is the opposite of what God does. Usually God is the source of good. God is love. God is love. And the nature of someone who's good to do good things. Umitzad Chesed, the Torah, because God is loving and God is good, God should have been leaving the soul in the upper worlds, constantly going up. But Khan here, God took the soul and he put it down into the world. You read a Gedola, a tremendous descent, into exile. From a high place to a low place. Right? So it's no wonder that there's people that are atheists, right? Who needs a God like that? They're going to believe in a God that takes the soul, it's so pure, and sends it down to this terrible place? Sign that God is not good. Or the Chas V'Shalom. Or to say that God, maybe there's no such thing. It's just a natural process. If there was God, he wouldn't put the soul down in the world. Says the Rebbe, now we can understand the fact is the tremendous highness that there is in serving God in this physical world. The amazing novelty that it was all worthwhile. This is the ultimate kindness of God, that he gives us responsibility, gives us a job in the world. It was worthwhile to make a dwelling in this world. It was well worthwhile for God to bring the soul down below. Not for the sake of the soul itself. The soul itself doesn't have to be fixed. Leave the soul up in the heavenly worlds. But in order to fix up the body and to fix up the world, to make a dwelling place for God in the world. You read it because by means of this descent into the world, to make a dwelling for God in the world, is brought about, is accomplished a tremendously high result, even higher than the soul itself when it was above. So in that way, it benefits the soul as well, revealing God's essence in the lower world. Odd until this, it draws down even in the soul. Shenosav also, that in addition to the fact that the soul reaches a tremendously high level, which is even higher than from the place it started from, there's a revelation of Tokif and Neshama, the revelation of the power of the soul, the power of victory of the soul, of defiance. Mekabelas and Neshama, the soul receives also a connection to the revelation of the essence of God. Because that's why God created the world. By means of God, the soul in the world. Okay, so what's the Rebbe saying over here? The world is good. God did not create the world as a testing ground, as a boot camp, as a whatever it is, as a maze that we just have to run this whole gamut of, you know, confusion and tests in the world. And then finally we get to the end, right? Like they used to have this Pac-Man thing. It just goes, you know, running around. And that's why God enjoys it. And he just enjoys watching us run around like little rats. Oh, look, he found the way to get out. This is really nice. That's one way of looking at it. That's the way. In fact, that's the way that the main way of looking at it, if you're a religious person, the main way of looking at the world, religious people look, is that God created the world because we'll get out. We're going to go to heaven. We're going to get heaven. So, but that makes God a little bit cruel. Because the soul, before it came into the world, it was already in heaven. The soul is in heaven. So it's like taking a person that's a billionaire and taking all the money away from him and putting him into a jungle and saying, if you get out, and the jungle is filled with poisonous snakes and all sorts of things, but if you get out, you get all of your money back. Huh? What do you say about that? Good deal, huh? What are you talking about? Give me my money. What are you taking my money for? No, that's the deal. But you'll be a billionaire. You get out, you'll be a billionaire. It's worth it. But I'm a billionaire now. Hey, it's the same thing. The soul, when it's in heaven, it was a billionaire. It was rich. And God sends the soul down. Why? Because if you're really good, you're going to go to heaven. But I was already in heaven, right? So here the Rebbe is saying, no. That's, you're looking at the whole thing. The whole picture you got is totally wrong. Because you're looking at a picture between you and God. And God did this to me, and I'm going to go back to God. And he says, not so. The world, in some way, is just as important to God as you and even God himself. For some reason or other, and this is not, it had to be this way. It had to be. It couldn't have been any other way, right? This is the way it had to be. This is God's will, right? God could do anything he wanted to. This is the way it had to be. There had to be a world. The world is important, infinitely, infinitely important to God, just like the Jewish people, just like God himself, to fix up the world. That's why we're here. We're not here to get out of the world. That's what Judaism says. That's why, interestingly enough, in the whole five books of Moses, it doesn't talk about heaven or hell. It doesn't mean that there's no such thing. God forbid, there certainly is heaven and hell. That's God's business. That's punishment and reward. But the whole essence of the whole business is to fix up the world, this physical world. Here in this physical world is where God gave the Torah. Here in this physical world is where there's the Holy Temple. Here in the physical world is going to be the raising of the dead, physical world. So we have no idea how important this physical world is to God. God wants to be revealed here. According to this, it's understood what it says. It's talk about Shlosh Devarim. You have to look at three things. And notwithstanding the great highness of the soul, how it was, the soul of a Jew is a portion of God from above. Chilek Eloka. But the service has to be, in addition to the fact that he makes from himself a dwelling place for God by means of learning Torah and doing the commandments, by revealing his soul and his body. But also you have to look at the third thing, namely to make a dwelling for God in the physical world. The olam, the olam of the world. Shall olam atzmo, that the world itself should be a dwelling for God. And by means of this, a person reaches to completion. Because this is the whole essence of a man. This is the whole purpose of our creation. Even though that a person working in the world is a tremendous descent, so it appears temporarily, but by means of this, it is brings about a tremendous elevation in oneself. That's what it means. You don't come to do sins. If a person only learns Torah, just him and God, right? He learns the Torah. So it's very, very, that's a very egotistical thing. And it's very, very likely that that person will come to things in the world making him angry, and things in the world all of a sudden getting this tremendous lusts, and he'll become depressed, and he'll become this because he doesn't have any, want to have any connection to the world. He's living in a terrible world. Everything around him is bad. And we're also part of the world. So everything, there's nothing happy. Nothing happy in the world. When are we happy? When we die. Oh, die. Oh, that's the best thing. To die, nothing like dying. You die, you're the happiest person in the world. To die, that's not Judaism. That's not Judaism. Maybe the other religions, they want to die. They want to go to heaven. The essence of Judaism is to fix up this world because God wants that. That's what God wants more than anything else. So by means of our service and making God a dwelling place in this world, by means of that, you won't come to do a sin. A feel of the day, you won't even come to the hands of a sin, a possibility for doing a sin. So according to this, now we can understand, a piece that we can understand also, why Geula is the letters Gola, exile, and you just add one letter, Aleph. Because you're not getting out of the world. You're fixing up, you're bringing an aleph into the golem, to the world. Geula, it doesn't negate the world, it doesn't negate the exile, but it includes inside of it the whole exile even more. This is a mailat geula al yaday shemachniso megale et alufa shalom. You bring the alufa shalom into the world. Now, I just thought of it. I mean, it's a terrible thing, but I just thought of this. Let's say it's the person that's sick, right? So the doctor says, I got the cure for it. Don't worry about it, right? I got to get, but all the doctors say, you know, we have to have a special treatment that you can get. I don't worry, I can fix the whole thing up. Goes, you hear a gunshot, that's it. I healed him. What did you do? I sent him to heaven. In heaven, there's no, now he's okay. Now he's okay, he's in heaven. He's not sick anymore. He's, that's what a doctor is for, to send people. Yeah, but excuse me, I have a few more patients to go. He puts another bullet in his gun. Hey, stop this guy. That's not right. All the religions in the world are saying we can fix up the whole problem. That's it. You die, you go to the world to have heaven, and that's it. Judaism says, no. We got to fix up the world. The world is sick, but we can fix it up. You can't get out of it. We're not getting out of it. How do you do it? You bring the Aluf HaShalom. You bring God, the Aluf HaShalom, the master of the world, Kivan Shekavanah, because the whole intention of God, why he made this whole building, why he's making it constantly, is that we should reveal God in the world. And how do we reveal God in the world, by the way? How do we do it? Just by doing commandments, by being giving charity, by learning Torah, by increasing good in the world, is by means of this, by being brave and standing up. That's ideally what's supposed to be the holy land of Israel. Is supposed to be an example to the whole world of what it means to be holy, how God is supposed to be. That's what means holy land. It's a place where God is revealed, where suddenly you see that the most mundane things are holy. Nowadays, mundane things are not holy, right? The family is not holy. Life is not holy. Children are not holy. Look what they're teaching children in the world, right? Order is not, education is not holy. Look how they're educating. Look what's going on in the universities. What's going on? Death and destruction, right? The woke movement, nothing is holy. Everything is meaningless. And making a dwelling for God in the world means suddenly a person is tremendously happy. He wakes up in the morning, I'm alive. And he has a wife, and he has a family, and he sees children, and he can help people, and he can be in the world. He's alive. Suddenly you start to appreciate the miracle of life. And even that means to make a dwelling in the physical world. Kol el kafi shetachtonim, how even including all the elements of the exile. The galut shalalufa, the galut, and it says even God is in exile. Matzav shame. I'm sorry. No, I'm sorry. No, I'm sorry. I go back. I take it back. Legalot, to reveal. The word legalot also means to reveal. To exile, to reveal the Aluf HaShalolam, the king of the universe, in the lowest places in the world, how the world is in exile. That is to take the world as it is in exile and to reveal God here. Adarav, even more. I'll give you another example. Let's say a piano, right? You have a next door neighbor that's smashing on the piano. You ever heard the joke? The joke says, he brings his friend over, says, I have a piano. You can tell time with a piano. He says, how can you do that? He says, wait, just wait a couple hours. He starts pounding on the piano. His next door neighbor yells out, it's 3 o'clock in the morning. What are you playing the piano for? Right? It just can make a lot of noise. You bring somebody and says, listen, I know how to fix up the piano. And he takes a big blowtorch and he just burns the whole thing down. That's it. The piano's picked. Then you bring somebody, an expert pianist, and you bring in, he knows how to play. Oh, this is really good. I thought the piano was only here to disturb the neighbors and to make trouble, take up room in my house. And now all of a sudden he knows how to play. The same thing, the world is a big pain in the neck. The world is a terrible place, but if there's someone who knows how to play at the music, then it becomes a beautiful thing. That's the purpose of man in the world, especially the Jews, to take the world and to make music out of it. Lachin, therefore, Tolu Yinyan, the whole idea of Geula, of redemption, depends on our service of God all the time of the exile. The Avoda, and this whole idea, we have to bring the Aleph, we have to bring godliness. And there's everything we do, say, think, we say, what would God want me to say? What does God want me to do? How do we know what God wants? Shulchan Aruch, look at the law book, look at what the Torah says. Aluf HaShalolam, the Geula in exile, Adja, by means of this, it becomes Geula, the world suddenly becomes healthy. The piano suddenly becomes beautiful. Rova Otiot, the majority of the letters, and even the beginning, the first letter of Geula, of redemption, is Gola, exile, like we said before. In other words, in addition to the fact that there's a tremendous elevation of us by means of our coming down into exile, like we said before, al derech tokef or Hashemah, by means of revealing the defiance and the goodness of the soul when it is down here in the world. This makes the gula, we make redemption from the exile. All we have to do is put an aleph. And in addition to that, there's also a dwelling for the essence of God. That suddenly there's a new revelation in the world that we didn't dream about. We didn't dream about. Like it was in Gan Eden before God, Adam sinned from the tree, even higher. That God himself, God's essence is revealed. And in the physical world itself becomes elevated by means of the elevation of all the things in the world. And that's what we'll stop now. I think maybe next week we'll even continue learning this Devar Malchut, even though that it's from this week's Torah portion, but I think that's what we'll do. We'll see. Yeah, I think so. Next week. Especially because this was in a double portion. So we'll continue next week. Okay, so but tomorrow we're going to do the Yom Yom, but tomorrow we'll learn the Kuti Torah. Okay, here we go. Stop the share.